We all dream of a future in space, but it would take a lot of work to get there, and more to make it a place we can visit and live. Of course, where there's work to be done, there's jobs to be had. As you came in to watch this video, you might have been wondering if the topic was going to be about current jobs in the space industry and how to get into one, or if we meant actual jobs physically taking place in space nowadays, or even those in the future. And the answer is yes, as we'll be discussing the current state of the industry and how to get into it, but also where it's going. That said, getting to be an actual astronaut anytime soon is genuinely possible, but not much easier than any time since the space race began, even with record numbers of launches, with 211 successful launches last year. Most don't have people on them, and there's only been a little over 100 new astronauts making their first trip to space since this show began almost a decade ago. If you're curious about how to improve your odds to become one, we did discuss that in depth in our episode back in the winter on selecting crew for a spaceship, and where we also tried to contemplate what some of the jobs on spaceships would be. Now, unlike most topics about the future, the further forward we look in time, the clearer the picture gets for jobs in space. Which is to say, for me, the primary point of space exploration and development is to set up permanent habitations there, settle new worlds, and create communities for mankind. At that time, pretty much any job you could have on Earth will find its equivalent in space, and a few new ones too, like those involving working in the vacuum, or making and monitoring breathable air supplies, or planetary terraformer, or when the job is done, the person who's worked is to monitor ecosystems and tweak them when the non-terrestrial conditions either derail a food chain and need adjusted back, or we need to entirely alter the ecosystem to some mix of Earth and that environment. That last is a long time off. And I also feel obliged to mention that artificial intelligence and superior automation could render many of these jobs non-existent, or at least very different to nowadays. Even without AI, we often picture future lifestyles in space and make analogies to our past or present, and mining settlements in the asteroid belt or on some barren planet are very common for this. Mining has often been a brutal business of very hard labor, but even where that persists now, it's mostly because existing operations have not upgraded their equipment and methods. Sometimes upgrading isn't viewed as worth it, for all the costs of setup and retraining, but a new operation being set up in the asteroid belt some decades or even centuries down the road would have very little reason to minimize automation, or make do with used mining equipment from Earth. We looked at this more in our episode's Nomadic Miners on the Moon and Life as an Asteroid Miner, but it's unlikely that space would see many close parallels to an old West Virginia coal mining town, though they have their own unique cases for problems we discussed in those episodes. We also don't want to take for granted that everything in space, or down here on Earth, is going to be seamlessly automated in the future. As I think time has demonstrated, inventing AI capable of learning does not result in an inevitable rapid plunge to Skynet days later. So technological singularities that could lead to humans not needing to do any work of any kind, possibly because we got obliterated, can doubtless happen, but not overnight. There's a build-up time to react, hopefully wisely, to cut off or restrict further progress down that road, even to go backwards if needed. But I don't expect to see an elimination of people in the workforce in our lifetime unless we also get radical life extension technology, which, to be fair, I think is decently plausible too. Of course, I love my work, so retirement holds little attraction to me personally. Your mileage may vary, but I tend to feel for most folks it's about finding the job they like. And I will say I've only met a few folks in space or the aerospace industry in general who didn't seem to enjoy theirs. The overwhelming majority love it. If you're contemplating a career in space, or anything else for that matter, that's a thing to keep in mind. If you love your work, you'll do it better, and it will reinvigorate you some days and stress you others, but you won't end up spending half your paycheck and free time trying to manage the stress your job gives you. There's also that big question of what people do with their time if not working. A lot of folks tend to think a shorter work week might be a good thing, but too short of one might be self-destructive to individuals and societies. This is another reason space is a good place to contemplate working in, because it's good to feel your work serves some greater purpose, and rarely do pioneers feel pointless about their work. Exploring the galaxy and settling space is a massive task and a mighty purpose for a civilization that needs one. It isn't likely to involve a lot of back-breaking labor. We do have automation for that, but there is a lot of work to be done in a galaxy in which untold trillions of worlds may need to be explored, settled, terraformed, or even constructed. Of course, where we want to be for today's purpose is sitting at the helm of a rocket ship, preferably one about to land on a strange and exciting new world with a breathable atmosphere and aliens with conveniently parallel biology to our own. Sadly, as we discussed in our Fermi Paradox series, that's only likely as a future because FTL isn't possible, and in a million or so years, every planet will be populated by mutated descendants of this planet who have similar biology for that reason. Aliens, if we find them, probably won't have enough brains to chat, and we might find alien life even in the solar system on Mars or Europa or elsewhere, which might open up the field of alien biology, xenology as it's sometimes called, but mostly to microbiologists, not anthropologists or space cowboys. Now you might be thinking, thanks for raining on the parade there, Isaac, but as much as I love space opera, it lacks much realism. And another of those is you'll be getting in fights with the laser equivalent of a sidearm and dogfighting spaceships around with a joystick or yoke. You probably would have an actual flight yoke to use for emergency landing and takeoff, and likely will be trained extensively in its use, but millisecond reaction times are not for meat brains, so when you need them, you either use a computer or have one stuck in your brain. Some jobs won't exist or might require augmentation. Others, like navigating a spaceship through deep space, are not a full-time job. It's actually a lot easier navigating around space than a planet, and the time scales involved mean it would just be one minor task added to some other job, like captain or XO or chief engineer. And in all probability, all three would be trained to do it and probably engage in it redundantly to avoid mistakes or even intentional misdirection if the captain went nuts or something. Indeed, a lot of the jobs we think of on ships from classic science fiction probably don't need to exist or would differ greatly from their portrayal. I want to talk about some of those jobs, even the more far future ones like terraforming or building megastructures, but as to the current industry, if you're thinking about getting into it and worry there's not many opportunities or that you have to be a scientist or engineer to get in, let me assure you otherwise. There are 18,000 employees of NASA and 16,000 military and civilian personnel in the newly created Space Force. There's still far more folks working as related contractors or scientists, and indeed a lot of folks who say they work for NASA are doing so through a company, university, or organization contracted to it. SpaceX has about 13,000 employees, if that gives some scale, and Blue Origin's about 11,000. The 18,000 technically and directly employed by NASA is only slightly more than either of those, and could never accomplish all the tasks needed by NASA on their own. At least 1 in 1,000 people in the US are employed in the space industry, and beyond that it depends on how we feel like defining that, as there's a couple million in aerospace alone, many of which are working whole or in part on space projects. A lot is how you define it, too. I obviously am in the space industry. More than half of my episodes relate to space, and any of my fellow YouTubers or podcasters or science journalists who spend a large portion of their work talking about space are in that industry and community. I'm also the president of the National Space Society, which is pretty much by definition in that sector, though we don't build or fly rockets ourselves. We just tell everyone why they should. Of course, many of our members work in space, some literally, as lots of astronauts are in the NSS, and some walk nowhere near space but just love space in general. One of the things the organization focuses on is trying to build the STEM pipeline for folks going into the space industry and helping them chart out a career and meet folks in it and employers in it. And it is a growing industry, so if you're having doubts about if you can find a job in the field, the answer is yes, even if you're not a physicist, mathematician, or engineer. As I mentioned earlier, the longer and deeper we explore, travel, and settle space, the more jobs that aren't science or engineering are going to pop up. But that is already true. I wrote this script back in early March, when SpaceX's Crew 8 mission was launching, and while waiting for the actual launch, I poked around their website, and they had 1,081 jobs currently posted. Some were internships, quite a few were senior something or other and Indian engineer, though often software engineer. Some required top secret clearance, but there were 30 openings just in the sales department, 20 in human resources, another dozen in customer service, similar for legal, and 55 in facilities operation, which included hospitality positions and everything from HVAC repair and sous chef and cook to barista and even spaceport mixologist. A quick scan around of other space companies and NASA tends to indicate the same wide selection. Many of the positions allow remote work, many require only a high school diploma. As usual, if you want to work on rockets without being an engineer or rocket scientist, being a welder is probably your best route, and there's a serious shortage of welders in general, so it is a pretty good path to steady employment that pays well. That presumably illustrates the point that there are jobs in the space industry right now for anyone who really wants them. It's also a sector that will grow as the number of people and objects in space grows. I should also say that like every other job, it's mostly non-exciting. While serving in Iraq, which I'm still surprised to think was almost two decades ago, I decided that excitement was not something I really wanted in my day very often. But even when we were out patrolling, escorting, or in active combat operations, it was 99% nothing going on, with lots of maintenance and training and waiting. Hence the US Army's unofficial motto, hurry up and wait. And that's true for space, too. And science or life in general, too. Patience should never be confused with thumb twiddling or apathy. The whole concept of delayed self-gratification is that it's sacrificing the present for a strong chance of that getting you more in the future, not patiently sitting there while nothing happens, or even while things fall apart. Sometimes knowing the difference can be tricky. That will come up a lot in ecosystems we build in space, or on other planets too, as it will be hard to build those and watch them deviate or vary, and try to decide if it's drifting to a new local and good point of stability, or headed toward an utter crash. And even now, the experiments we are performing with basic biology and medicine on the space station for humans and other organisms is helping us figure out what we need to adjust and prepare for when trying to build new ecosystems on strange new worlds. The long-term extension of that is terraforming, but in the shorter term, it will come up with hydroponics, and that will be a critical role in space for providing fresh food, air, and water, as well as green spaces for people a million miles from home. One thing the urbanization of the last century taught us was how important having plants and critters in our concrete and steel jungles was for our psychology and health. Something you don't see in science fiction very often is the ship's garden or ship's hydroponics. Both Star Trek Voyager and Stargate Universe showed us some on-ship hydroponics, though the scale was laughably tiny for the size of the crews they were meant to feed. I recently got to be one of the judges for VRChat Space Jam, and the entries were unbelievably awesome. The event coordinator, the NSS Australia Vice President Greg Hunter, told me some folks had added in O'Neill cylinders to their awards just because they heard I'd be a judge, and it was amazing to see. But I only saw a few entries of the garden or hydroponics, and again, very small, yet very critical to space. One important thing to understand is that even with most food plants, the amount of edible calories you need for a person is going to be a lot higher than the amount you need for regenerating carbon dioxide into oxygen. You're also going to have a lot of scraps left over that are inedible for humans, and you could compost those directly, but I would tend to assume in most cases you would be using them to feed some animals that could digest them or to make into biofuel or bioplastics. Mini spaceships on shorter runs might opt to go for mechanical scrubbing of air to remove carbon dioxide and other particles, and trade waste air and waste water when arriving at a port. It probably depends on how many people are on that ship and how long it's away between stops. Hydroponics is considered the go-to because it's low mass, no need to haul lots of dirt around, but you would probably see lots of dirt farming and gardening too, especially on stationary objects like asteroid bases or space stations or lunar and planetary outposts. Grow local, eat local has a whole different meaning when the nearest farming operation might be 100 million miles away, not 100, so this is likely to be a big chunk of jobs in space. It's also an example of how a big task might get most of its labor provided by a large but part-time pool, as much of it would be routine and easy to train, and odds are good a lot of folks on long-duration missions will want to spend time in with the green stuff, so using that to produce food, recycle air and water, help the crew get some exercise, and some mentally healthy time in a decent approximation of nature is hitting four birds with one stone, and all of them critical ones that could lead to mission failure without their presence. In that regard, most smaller crews and outposts of the nearer future probably don't have a janitor either. Just someone like the XO designated to assign cleaning chores and other maintenance and make sure it's getting done. The bigger the ship and outpost, the more specialized and full-time jobs it's likely to generate, until eventually it just resembles any town in modern times, or future times. Again, if we need it here on Earth, we'll eventually need it in space. But in the more mid-term, the next couple of centuries, what are some big jobs in space we would expect to need? We'll skip on ship crew. You always need someone in charge and someone next in line. You always need folks able to do medicine too, physical and mental. See our episode Staying Sane in Space for some reminders why mental health is really important in space and all the extra ways it can drive you bananas. You also always need your pilot for ships, even with a good autopilot, unless it's truly human smart kind of good, in which case it is basically a person anyway and probably still deserves that title. Same for your holographic medical personnel waiting for you to state the nature of the medical emergency. Some things can also be sourced back to Earth. Your space colony, even if it has tens of thousands of people, really does not need a local equivalent to the Pentagon or Supreme Court. Even if it did need some on-site lawyers and folks serving in security roles by then. You don't need a biologist for every sub-discipline either, just one good enough as a generalist to know who to consult for complex situations and how to get them the data they need, including things they don't know or think to ask for, such as how an expert with some bit of microbiology back on Earth might not have thought to ask what your spin gravity or day length was set to on the ship or outpost. Especially when you have time lag on every signal, and the practicalities of long-distance communication limit bandwidth. I think folks assume sometimes that experts back here on Earth are going to be able to see every nook and cranny of a ship or base in glorious 4K ultra-high definition, but interplanetary broadcasts are very energy-intensive, and you need to keep that data very compressed and minimal. But even with good bandwidth, there's just a lot of things an expert back home isn't going to be thinking of, because they're not actually there experiencing it. So you do want someone trained in almost everything to at least a basic level. Thus, you probably have gardeners, botanists, doctors, and various other biology and life science people working in space, both remotely and physically. The same is true of geologists, or their extraterrestrial equivalents. If you're on some rock, it's either to study it scientifically or to exploit its minerals, and that means the geologist is king there. Something we rarely see in sci-fi. Whether it's the moon or an asteroid or the Martian surface, advanced probing, or just collecting regolith and rock samples remotely with a drone, that's critical to that mission, from helping select landing sites and planning exploration routes to charting out that planet's future economy. We discussed that more last week in Colonizing Ganymede. Space habitat engineers and architects able to design and maintain the living and working structures are critical too. This ensures the base is sustainable and can protect the inhabitants from the local environment. Every leak, every expansion, every choice for the next building to fabricate and what to do it from needs serious consideration from an expert, and again, even if they call back home for guidance, it really helps to have someone trained in it to relay on concerns and instructions and oversee them actually getting implemented. Speaking of instructions, we talk about using robots a lot, but someone has to repair those robots, and the environments they are working in will often be beyond brutal. It is hard to say how roboticized our future in space will be. It's likely to vary a lot by time and place, but I doubt it will ever be zero. And even if it's so automated that robots repair each other and build new ones, you'll still need someone auditing them and checking them to make sure they're not going all paperclip maximizer on you. In most cases, this is going to involve that engineer or repairman being trained and able to go outside into the harsh environment in question to go repair that damaged robot. Though in many cases, another robot might be sent to drag it back in. And presumably a robot technician is decently skilled at doing repairs robotically too. Nonetheless, this could easily end up being one of the more exciting and dangerous jobs in space, be it going out into the harsh Martian dust storms to fix a robot, or going EVA in space to fix one. And if a robot can't do it, a person still needs to, and that means pretty much all of your personnel in space need at least some training and experience with EVA, extravehicular activities and missions, as a stressful crisis is not the best time to get used to working in a clunky suit while trying to manipulate tools while also feeling like you might drown in your own sweat. Spacesuits will probably get more comfortable in time, but we shouldn't take that for granted. I dare say, spacesuit designers will be a big one back home, and spacesuit tailors will all play important roles in the emerging space community, and someone able to repair and alter spacesuits is likely to find themselves in high demand. It's very likely we will develop something lighter and designed for short-term exposure to vacuum that people could wear too, as opposed to the massive rigs current spacesuits need to be. Something you could wear in low-priority sections of a base or ship where the hull or dome was thinner and cheaper, maybe in an agricultural dome or blister, where loss of pressure just damages some crops rather than kills anyone, unless someone happened to be inside at the time, in which case some lighter suit comes in handy. But fundamentally, everyone has to be trained in EVA and in proper protocols for tethering everything and not ejecting stuff into space, especially orbital space, where it might return to smash into someone's vessel with 1,000 times the energy a bullet the same size would have. One big job in space, be it groundside or orbital, is going to be debris monitoring and clearance, and we discussed the how-tos of that back in our space debris episode in the winter. And there's a fun anime called Planetes that follows the work of a debris clearance team that is certainly dramatized, but does the science and mechanics pretty good. There's another short-lived action series from the 1970s that looks at life in the space garbage industry too, Quark, though how well either would prepare you for a job in that field is hard to say. I mentioned earlier that we can't assume missions far from Earth will have much bandwidth, and sending signals back and forth is a lot trickier than pointing an antenna or dish in the right direction and hitting a button. An important job in space will be a communications specialist, ensuring data transmission of scientific research, navigation, daily operations, and personal signals home. You want to be able to send all that encrypted because astronauts will want their private messages and banking to stay private like anyone else. And maintaining the software, as well as the actual equipment, is critical. If your communication gear breaks, you can't talk to anyone at home to get help to fix it, or anything else till that repair happens. For that reason, lots of redundancy is good here, and you need to ensure whoever is in this job is able to rig up at least a basic communication system from available materials, since wrecking communications gear and its backups is the most obvious way to attack or sabotage a mission. The same is true of whatever is providing your power to run all your air scrubbers, rocket engines, or ion drives, heating and cooling, and so on. My personal guess is that most facilities will maintain both a decent supply of batteries and an RTG capable of at least running their comms, computers, and air scrubbers or vents. An RTG, or radioisotope thermal generator, while inefficient, is about as simple, durable, long-lasting, and foolproof a device as they come. Hence why we still have working ones on spacecraft that haven't received maintenance in decades. There's no electrician to call in, and along with a plumber and a welder, you really need talented folks and trained folks on hand. And you aren't just talking about not being able to get a shower in or the air getting a bit uncomfortable if this breaks. Your clogged pipes might get followed by a reactor meltdown. Or, on a base on Mercury for instance, a countdown clock to how long you all had before being cooked when the cooling breaks down. You can slap a patch on a leak too. In many cases, even a thin piece of plastic over a hole would work, but eventually someone needs to properly weld that leak. And then there's simple logistics and the need for a supply chain manager, not just to oversee inventory, but also to prioritize and estimate what needs resupply missions from Earth, and the efficient use and replenishment of resources to ensure the sustainability of the base overall. Every extra spare part or redundant component you bring costs mass, and huge amounts of fuel to get there, but there is no Walmart or Amazon or dollar store nearby to get things from, and even a shortage of something like pens and pencils could seriously impede proper function. This is one case where 3D printing comes in real handy, and is the last job we'll mention today, but is also one where we wouldn't expect to see it as much on Earth as in space. On Earth, we can get away with huge supply chains, and they usually result in a better product for a lower cost or effort. In space, having a feedstock for producing good enough items by 3D printing is a huge advantage. And so having someone trained not just in running one, but knowing how to upload or model something for printing, and who can repair that printer, or create new feedstock, will be vital to running bases without needing to bring along tons of spare parts, or an entire machine shop and skilled machinist, though that's also a great thing to have if you can manage it. On a last note, while NASA works hard to help us explore space and prepare the road to develop it, it's not really what they're designed for. Much as we eventually need to have a space force to take that burden off NASA and the various military branches that were trying to handle it, we will eventually need cabinet-level offices for everything we have here but for up in space. But sooner than later, we'll need something like a space development department to focus on not just developing space commercially, but helping us start figuring out what sort of labor force development we're going to need so we're not shooting blind or making semi-educated guesses. And I'd guess the sooner that happens, the better, assuming it's done right, of course. In the long term, as we said, there's a role for everyone in space. But in the short term, if you dreamed of working in the space industry, you really can make that a reality through some hard work and determination. And when it comes to actual jobs in space, as we showed today, there will be a lot of options available, and perhaps not that far over the horizon. Today we looked at jobs in space, and as we saw, there's already tons of jobs in the space industry, many of which do not require a background in math, science, or computer science. Nonetheless, that is the biggest portion of them. If you think you have a career in space or technology in general, but don't tend to think of yourself as a math whiz, do not let that intimidate you. Math, data, science, computers, and AI can be fun and easy to learn with the right partner, and that's where Brilliant.org can help you out. They specialize in creating fun, interactive, bite-sized, and effective learning that lets you go from the basics all the way to advanced materials. Brilliant's the longest-running sponsor of this show, and in that whole time, I've heard a lot of praise from those who tried it out, and to date, I haven't seen a single complaint. And I think it's because they focus on continuously improving their own content so they can better help you continuously improve your own skills. And they also know the best approaches. Brilliant.org helps you build critical thinking skills through problem-solving, not memorizing. So while you're building real knowledge on specific topics, you're also becoming a better thinker. Build real knowledge in minutes a day, with fun lessons you can do whenever you have the time. Learn through problem-solving and doing, with hands-on interactive content that's fun, immersive, effective, and intuitive. You can try everything Brilliant has to offer for free for a full 30 days. Just visit brilliant.org/IsaacArthur or click on the link in the description. You also get 20% off an annual premium subscription. So we're done for today, but we're just getting started for June. And next week, on June 9th, we will return to the Fermi Paradox and the nature of intelligence to ask if our minds themselves may be a ticking time bomb waiting to inevitably ruin us. After that, we'll have a pair of episodes on oceanic moons, ones with surface seas, and paradise planets, places even better than Earth for us to live. Then we'll ask what would have happened if the dinosaurs had never died off on June 20th. If you'd like to get alerts when those and other episodes come out, make sure to hit the like, subscribe, and notification buttons. You can also help support the show by becoming a member here on YouTube or Patreon, or check out other ways to help at IsaacArthur.net. You can also catch all of SFA's episodes early and ad-free on our streaming service, Nebula, along with hours of bonus content like in-situ resource utilization at go.nebula.tv/IsaacArthur. As always, thanks for watching and have a great week.